Good morning. My name is Paul Pearson. I'm the chair of the Charles and Louise Travers Department of Political Science, and it's my great pleasure to kick off this event, the 13th annual Travers Conference. And I know, I think that Charles and Louise Travers would have been very pleased with the topic for discussion today. And I want to thank the Travers family, as every year, for the contributions that they're making to the university and to the department in setting up the kind of program that we're able to do to talk about issues about the quality of governance and encouraging sustained and thoughtful dialogue on matters of enduring public interest. And I don't think there's much that people could be more interested in today in the state of California than the topic for today's meeting. It's my pleasure to introduce, at the beginning of this conference, a person who is maybe the single most tireless and eloquent spokesperson in expressing what's at stake in the current situation in California politics and the risks that exist to tremendous investments that generations of Californians have made to build public institutions like the one that we're sitting in today. So my pleasure to start the conference by welcoming Chancellor Robert Birgeneau.
So thank you so much for the kind introduction, and good morning, everyone, and welcome to the University of California, Berkeley, and the 13th annual Travers Conference on Ethics and Accountability. And I'm especially pleased to welcome Travers family. As always, we see each other continuously at football games. So it's also great to see you at academic events as well. And I know just how important your contributions to the social sciences, your family's contributions here at UC Berkeley have been. I also, although I think they may not have arrived yet, want to welcome former Senate and Assembly Republican leader Jim Brulte, and also we have a last-minute substitution for Fabian Nunez, who apparently contracted the flu, and we're going to have the pleasure of having Treasurer Bill Lockyer, who's always entertaining and provocative, and the two of them will be delivering the lunch keynote address, which without doubt will be very interesting. You may remember Bill is the one who floated the idea of, you know, maybe we should cut UC loose and let them charge arbitrary fees. It was to be provocative, not as a serious proposal, but I did get to have a rather elaborate exchange with him about that. I also want to extend a special welcome to the students of Monte Vista High School in Cupertino and their teacher, Christopher Chang. And I know that you will enjoy today, and I hope to see as many as possible of you back here one day as entering freshmen in our freshman class. There's a school not a little closer to Cupertino, which you might think about also, but I guarantee you'll have a much better life experience here at Berkeley. Of course, I don't know when the planning for this conference actually began, but obviously, from the point of view of all Californians, but most especially those who are responsible for public institutions here, that the subject, what ails California, could not be better timed. And I commented that I hate whining generally, but I'm going to whine anyway, just to give you a context of where we are right now at UC Berkeley and what the consequences are for us of the current challenges in the way the state finances higher education. On July 1 here at Berkeley, we began the academic year facing a budget deficit of $150 million. That's out of an operating budget, which is about $500 million, thereabouts, which is just an astounding amount. And really the worst part of it, from the point of view of being in my role as chancellor, but then also for the provost, et cetera, is it was at the end of May that we found out that we had an additional cut of $80 million, which we then had to adjust for by July 1. This now means that, in terms of the operating budget, that the state of California now provides just slight, in operating funds, the state of California now provides just slightly more than 20% of our total budget. So as I said sarcastically in the past, but unfortunately we're realizing it, we're progressively evolving from a state-supported to a state-assisted to a state-located university. It's only two decades ago that the state provided more than 50% of our total budget. A way of quantifying the shortfall is that this September, we joyously had about 9,000 new students turn up here at Berkeley. That includes new undergraduate students coming in as freshmen, transfer students, and graduate students. And that's about 9,000, a way of stating the budget cut is we have zero funds from the state for any one of these students. So we're being asked to educate the entire entering class with zero funds from the state. And you know, I don't have to tell you that that's not a sustainable financial model for a great university. It may be a sustainable model for a university that wants to progressively evolve into mediocrity, but that's not an option we're willing to consider. So it means that we both need a reversal of the state disinvestment, plus we will need our own financial model to evolve, and I'll comment on that briefly. Just to benchmark these cuts to other constituencies in the state, between 2000, year 2000, 2001, and 2007, 2008, Cal State expenditures grew by 30% from $78.9 billion to $103 billion. During the same time, this 8-year or 7-year period, prison spending doubled, K through 12 spending increased 42%, and health and human services spending increased 46%. While UC received only 2% more, which is essentially flat in state funds over this period. So UC stayed flat. The single statistic which I find most shocking, but also illustrative of many of the ills that we face, is that there were more prisoners in our state prison system in 1982 than there are prison guards. There are fewer prisoners in 1982 than there are prisoner guards today. I mean, think about that. Fewer prisoners in 82 than we have prison guards in 2009, and that tells you an incredibly disturbing story, actually. Of course, you know, you will have heard some of the things that we're doing in order to try to compensate for the very large state cuts. One of them, which has not yet been approved by the Regents, going to be before the Regents in the November Regents meeting, is a jump in fees by, I think it's between the spring semester and next fall, by 32%. That will mean in a 13-month time period, fees for undergraduate students will have gone up by 45.4%. Which is, again, a shocking number and not sustainable. Secondly, we've looked carefully here at replacing progressively, this is a recommendation by the Academic Senate, about 10% of our, of actually over-enrolled California residents. So we will stay over-enrolled, but replace the over-enrollment by out-of-state students. That's at least a plan recommended by the Academic Senate progressively over the next 4 years. Third, we've launched a really significant effort to streamline all of our administrative processes across the university. Fourth, we're doing a whole variety of other things on the business front. We're in the middle of a actually quite successful fundraising campaign, and we've been really encouraged by the way in which our alumni and friends have stepped up to help us address these issues. Actually, just yesterday I got from one of our friends, who believe it or not is a Stanford professor, who is funding an interdisciplinary chair, which will be a $3 million chair, because of his concern about the situation that he's a Cal grad, of course, that Cal finds itself in. So that's pretty encouraging. One of the things that's really been interesting, I used to complain, having spent much of my adult life in Boston on the faculty at MIT, that having moved here to California, that the East Coast media, New York media, thinks that the United States ends at the Hudson River, and that Washington, D.C. media think that the United States ends at the Potomac. And so it's been very difficult to penetrate the East Coast media with all of the great things going on here in our universities in California, but also some of the challenges. I can tell you that has changed dramatically. I mean, it's really been a transformation, which has been quite interesting as a bit of sociology. So first of all, and I'm not going to talk about that here, but some of you may know that Frank Yeary and I have proposed a radically different model for the support of public universities to restore completely their public character by partnering with the federal government. The Washington Post not only published that, they published that our article enthusiastically, and it's gotten an extraordinarily strong response. Interestingly, mostly from the East Coast, actually, and I guess the middle of the country. Secondly, we've had the New York Times, multiple times, the New York Times. Bob Herbert wrote just a wonderful op-ed on the situation we face. New York Times have been back repeatedly, and I have actually the New Yorker magazine coming to talk to me on Monday. So it's been very interesting that there's been an enormous interest. Of course, we don't completely welcome it, because the tone a little bit is like gloating, see, California's failing. This is not something that's acceptable. Finally, I just wanted to comment that one of the other interesting things that happened recently, which I'm sure you all may have read about, or which I participated in, is a couple of weekends ago, I went to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences in Cambridge, Massachusetts, for their induction ceremony. And one of the inductees who spoke was Chief Justice Ron George, who was inducted into the American Academy. And my wife and I were sitting there almost shocked at how very direct his speech was, and specifically pointing out, and I know you'll talk about this throughout the day, that asserting that the California system of participatory democracy through propositions has had incredible unintended consequences. And he pointed out, based on recent round of propositions, that our state voted to give chicken rights while denying similar rights to gay and lesbian citizens of the state, which shows just how far how broken the proposition system is, in my opinion. On the other hand, our state has been incredibly resilient, and I'm quite confident that we will recover as we've recovered from challenges in the past, and I hope that this forum today will help provide a roadmap for the recovery. And I don't have to tell you, it's clear that education all of the way, beginning in kindergarten, but I'm in particular responsible for one of our great higher education institutions, that education will play a central role in this. It's absolutely certain, and we are not going to let the University of California deteriorate. One way or another, we will find strategies that will enable us to maintain our excellence, and our challenge is going to be to simultaneously maintain our public character and to maintain access in the way we have historically. And as part of that, actually here at Berkeley, in our fundraising campaign, our focus over the next 2 years is going to be on raising substantial monies for financial aid to assure access, not just for people from really very low-income families, but for the middle class as well. So finally, let me just say thank all of you for coming here, and I really look forward to hearing the results of this day's conference, which I'm certain will be both stimulating and exciting. Thank you.
Thank you, Chancellor. We've got a really powerhouse lineup of panels running all through the day. And before launching into this, I wanted to also just say thanks to Professor Chris Ansell, who took the lead in organizing this, and which he has done for this conference for the last few years, and he just has done a fabulous job. And I think people are really in for a lot of stimulating discussion today. Before we get going on the panels, we wanted to start off with a kind of context setting, framing a presentation. We couldn't have found anybody better to do this than Jack Citrin, who is going to make this initial presentation. I first came across Jack's work when I was on the other end of the country over 20 years ago when I read a book that he wrote about Proposition 13 called Tax Revolt, Something for Nothing in California, which sounds still resonates today quite well, I would say, even after all that time. So Jack, who is now Heller Professor of Political Science in the Travers Department of Political Science and is also Director of the Institute for Governmental Studies here at Berkeley, combines two enduring interests that I think really will help to set up this conference well. He has been a longtime careful student of California politics, but in particular, he has an interest in trying to understand that most mysterious of entities for scholarly examination, the California voter. So he's going to tell us a little bit about that this morning.
Thank you, Paul, and as Director of Institute of Governmental Studies, which is cooperating with the Department of Political Science, sort of my dual lives in both of these institutes, I'm really privileged to participate in this. I think we are privileged that Chancellor Birgeneau took time from his incredibly busy schedule to make those necessary and important remarks about the state and about the university. So, Bob, thank you so much for coming, and thanks, of course, to the Travers family for enabling this to go on. Charles's father, Colonel Travers, was someone whom I had the great pleasure of knowing often, as Bob was saying, at football games, but he represented a kind of a person that we need increasingly, and that is someone with a deep and abiding love of the university and a love that persisted despite the ups and downs and the agreements and disagreements he may have had with particular decisions that were made, and we need that kind of actually support in general from the larger public. Title of this is California's Government and the People in the People's Court, because I'm a student of public opinion and believe that whatever our complaints about the voter, national, state, local, we do live in a democracy, and unless people who govern can develop, enjoy, and sustain the trust and confidence of the people they rule, you do not have a sustainable context for policy making. So that's the framework from which I begin. I want to first of all say that my colleague here, Iris Hui, who is a very excellent member of our department, completing her PhD and going on the job market, and she'll be a success. Iris is responsible not only for the slides, but also for doing a lot of the data analysis and putting this talk together for me. So Iris, thank you very much. And I will say this one last sort of introductory remark before I get going, and that is that you're going to see data that some of you have already seen. This is data, public opinion data, that comes from the Public Policy of Institute of California polls and the Field Institute polls, and some of this has been already outed, as we say, in the last couple of weeks, but I will take some, along with Henry Brady, who's sitting here, Dean of Graduate School of Goldman School of Public Policy, excuse me, Henry, and also Professor of Political Science. Henry and I participated in a group that wrote some of these questions, so we can claim some authorship. Okay, so let's get started.
Once upon a time, there was a tavern where we used to raise a glass or two. Remember how we laughed away the hours. Think of all the great things we would do. Those were the days, my friend. We thought they'd never end. We'd sing and dance forever and a day. We'd live the life we choose. We'd fight and never lose, for we were young and sure to have our way.
Those were the days. But as we say, nothing is forever. And actually, navel gazing is a sort of quintessential California trait. And when asked what ails California, or even more dramatically, I read a recent article in a journal called National Affairs called Who Killed California? A familiar prescription actually is, let's bring back the good old days of Pat Brown, when California's version of the New Deal financed economic growth and a flourishing public sector of outstanding universities, modern water projects, freeways, and parks. I want to say, unfortunately, that was then, and this is now, and the California of the 50s and 60s is no more. Iris, maybe the next couple of slides. Okay. And next. Okay. So we have a dramatically larger, a dramatically different, a dramatically more diverse state, and that creates, I think, a dramatically greater problem of getting coherence, cohensus, consensus, and a sense of direction that people will accept and agree to. So let me then go to the question. What ails California? When you say what ails anything, this calls for a medical diagnosis. So when I was asked to speak about what ails California, first thing I did was I rushed to my primary care physician. And the first thing he said to me, Cal, he's renaming me Cal for California, relax a little bit. You are not alone. There's a pandemic of illnesses in the American states, cuts in school funding, shrinking state services, layoffs, furloughs, budgetary gimmicks, prayers for stimulus money. They are the rule, not the exception. If you think California is sick, then New York, Arizona, Nevada, and Indiana are in the hospice ward. So, you know, feel good about yourself. You're not as bad off. Well, this was not very satisfying. I said, Schadenfreude is okay, but this is not a cure. I said, you know, doctor, I feel worse. I don't really care how New York feels. And a lot of people agree with me, and I want you to refer me to specialists. Well, we have what is called a Cadillac healthcare plan at the University of California, soon to be taxed perhaps, so before it's taxed, I said, send me to specialists. I just don't want one, I want two opinions. So he says, okay, fine, I write it up. So my first visit to the specialist was to someone called Dr. Carla Marx, and her diagnosis was very straightforward. Said, Cal, you're anorexic. Proposition 13 choked the money supply needed to fund the public sector. Two-thirds rule for passing the budget gives a reactionary minority control over public policy. The initiative process has emasculated representative government and allowed moneyed interests and individuals to shape public policy. Moreover, term limits have squeezed any intelligence out of the legislature. You need to eat more, eat more. Eat nutritiously, and all will be well. In other words, this is a very simple problem that money can solve. Well, in serious matters, as I say, you need a second opinion. So I go to my second opinion. Next stop was to the office of Dr. Myra Friedman. And Dr. Myra Friedman, her diagnosis was also one word. He says, you're obese. You're not anorexic. You're obese. You've been eating too much. Too richly,
And even worse, after you've had a bunch of meals because you had a good year at Gary Danko's and Chez Panisse, you know, now your credit card's overdrawn, you refuse to diet. You sneak outside to overdose on Reese's peanut butter cups. There once was a spending limit, but you found a way around it. Governors Jerry Brown and Gray Davis gave too much power to the public employee unions, so you have to feed them a rich diet as well as taking care of yourself. Says, thank God for the two-thirds rule for the budget and raising taxes, or you may eat yourself into the grave. So we got anorexia or obesity. So, you know, in some sense, in a matter of politics, like in body type, it's a matter of aesthetics or philosophy, not medicine. In some sense, what ails California, I think Chancellor Birgeneau put it this way, boils down to a philosophical central question. What is the role of the state, and how should that role be financed? And this is, in some sense, not a problem that involves tinkering with institutions, but that involves political culture, political belief, political philosophy. Okay. Now, my self-diagnosis, you know, which now with Google you can be your own doctor, is essentially to focus not so much on the particular institutional problems and solutions, but a larger problem, which I sort of, because this is sort of my research over the last 30 years, you can't give up the only thing that you really know, is I think there's, in some sense, a crisis of legitimacy, a crisis of confidence, and we're going to show this in these slides, that for better or worse and for reasons that we could debate and argue over, it's not so much that we could say objectively that representative government in California has failed, although some people say that, but in some sense the public believes it has failed. The public believes it has failed. And I think that when we talk about all these initiatives, most of the main initiatives that we've talked about and that people complain about represent a repudiation of the establishment by the people. And that is, I think, a fundamental issue that confronts the state and that people like Chancellor Birgeneau are confronting directly. And this is, in some sense, as the pendulum swings, we got to stop the pendulum swinging from obesity to anorexia and back, and that is a kind of a difficult kind of problem. So I want to sort of come back to make a few concluding remarks, but before that, let me just, together with Iris, run you through the diagnosis or the public opinion data that leads me to reach this conclusion, and I think Henry and I have spoken about this in a number of contexts, maybe not in identical language, but I think with the same general cast. So Iris, let's begin, and part one is very simple. Could you go back one slide? Mistrust and dissatisfaction, just the facts. Okay, so let's go very quickly through some familiar slides. First one is people's approval of the government, of the governor, and the Davis regime and the Schwarzenegger regime. And you can see the red line of disapproval is widening, going up, and the blue line of disapproval is, you know, slinking its way down to zero. Okay, that's the governor. Let's move on to the governor's partner in government, another branch of government, the legislature. And you can see here that over the last decade, how with just, you know, a little dip there, you get kind of widening gap between approval and disapproval. Okay. Next thing is, how do people feel California is heading? How are we doing in terms of the direction? Is the state on the right track or the wrong track? This very much tracks the economy, the state of the economy. So this is a kind of reflects the macro level economic condition of the nation and the state. But as you can see again, people aren't happy or satisfied with where they think the state is going. Next, we move to something that is more directly political. Do you trust, how much time do you think you can trust the government in Sacramento to do what is right? And so the top line, the red line, is only some of the time or none of the time, and the blue line is about always or most of the time. And once again, we see this huge sort of huge imbalance in the direction of mistrust. Next one is the state government wasteful? Well, this is the PPIC data over time. Over time, yet again, more and more people say that the state wastes a lot of money rather than just some money or not very much money. This is, of course, a standard complaint in American political culture. It's almost like a ritualistic comment. Of course they waste a lot of money. This is a kind of a general one. But let's go to the next chart. This next chart, this is a question that Henry and I wrote, and it was asked both in May 08 field poll and just recently October. And this question is, you know, says the reality the state faces is gigantic budget cut, a budget deficit, $20 billion or more. Do you think it could be, do you agree or disagree that the same level of services could be provided due to the amount of waste? And you see there, and of course there are party differences. This is also broken down by Democrats, Republicans, and independents. But even after a year of budgetary strife, you know, a large majority seem to think that there's so much waste and inefficiency in state government that they could balance the budget without serious cuts. Now we know Tim Hodson, who's in the audience and who knows a hell of a lot more about California government than I ever will know, said yesterday that if you ask the question, you know, in terms of state workforce, where does California rank in the 50 states? It ranks 49th. So it's not that there's a huge, huge, huge state workforce in relative terms. Now they may, you know, the size of the workforce and the cost of the workforce are not the same thing, and those fewer people may be paid more than they are in other states. But the fact of the matter is that in terms of this empirical reality of the size of the state government, nonetheless, people have this deeply rooted perception, and it cuts reasonably well across party lines, that there's just a lot of waste out there, and that the same could be done with, you know, a lot less money. Okay, so that's the first set. So the next question is, okay, well, what kind of a government do we want? And here we pose this as populism versus representation. Populism is kind of the label for the initiative process, which Chancellor Birgeneau referred to. And what do people feel about the initiative process? For all its flaws, and I think if you poll in detail, people will accept and recognize that there are many flaws in the initiative process. But nonetheless, the level of mistrust of representative institutions is such that the institution of the initiative is popular. Let's go, Iris, with this. Okay, here's a question. You can read it better than I. Do you think the public policy decisions made through the initiative process are better or worse than those made by the government and the legislature? From 2000 to 2008, during this entire decade, the initiative process wins. The initiative process wins, and it wins with Democrats and Republicans and independents. Okay? So that's one question. Another question, similar thing. Who should have the most? This is a slightly different question. Who should have the most influence? And so you give the governor, the legislature, and the green line is the initiative process. And again, over a decade, the green line is the largest line. So more people would say that the people voting through initiative should have more of a say than either the governor and the legislature. The only time when that's not a plurality is more recently among Democrats who favor the legislature, which of course was controlled by the Democrats, right? So, uh, So you have, again, this enduring desire on the part of the public, a suspicion of elected officials, and a desire for some kind of voice or control. Next one is term limits. Another controversial feature imposed by initiative, and which many people believe has kind of weakened the capacity of the legislature to make intelligent policy by removing institutional memory and expertise. But if you ask people, this is recently, when is this? This is just in October 2009. Early this month, you see once again the sort of general view that term limits have helped rather than hurt California. Okay, now we move to the budget crisis. How should be handled it? Should there be more taxes? Taxes versus spending, some of the specific issues that have been raised for reform. And we can go through this also very quickly. Iris, why don't we start? Okay. Field poll, May 2008. Would you prefer that the state government deal with the current large budget deficit mostly through spending cuts or through tax increases? Well, you know, we know at the university what spending cuts means, and this is the task that we have to convince the public, because once again, you see that, you know, cut spending over increase taxes is the majority. And if you look at the Democrats, even there, which is somewhat surprising, you know, posed in that dichotomous way, spending cuts win out slightly. Okay, next. This is a more general kind of question, and this goes to the subtitle of my old book, Something for Nothing, when you say, would people don't want to pay the taxes, but if you say, you know, would you like to see more services or fewer services? More services tends to dominate, except among Republicans. But here you see a slight difference over a one-year period, perhaps in the context of the recognition of the economic crisis, is that between 08 and 09, the sort of generalized expression for more services actually declined in all groups. Okay, next, Iris. Okay, this slide I'm going to go very quickly because it's commonsensical. It says, of the people who think there is a lot of waste in government, as opposed to there's not much waste in government, they're less willing to say we want more services. So obviously this kind of almost, you know, logic, common sense, that if you think there's a lot of waste and you can get the same level of services anyway, you're not going to advocate, in some sense, increasing services. Okay, next. Here's a sort of a different question. This is not from the Field Institute. This is for the it's a reprise on how the budgetary crisis should be solved. And here the blue line is not just services versus taxes, but a mix of spending cuts and tax increases versus just spending cuts or just tax increases. And you see that among the Democrats, there's a substantial majority in favor of some kind of mix, whereas among, and the independents share that, and among the Republicans, you have this very, very strong pro tax cuts or opposition to any tax increases. This is familiar. This was replayed in the state legislature. The partisan divide there is reflected here in public opinion. Okay, we can skip this slide, Iris, and we can move now to specific things. Okay, one of the proposals out there is that there should be a spending cap, amend the state constitution to impose a strict cap on the amount the state could spend each year. That is, the public as a whole is divided on this very closely, with once again the familiar partisan divide. Democrats opposed, Republicans in favor. Next. Okay. This is, again, we can skip because it simply reflects that the more waste you think there is, the more in favor of a spending cap you are. That, again, seems pretty logical. Okay, good. Another proposal, pay-as-you-go budgeting. In other words, that if there is going to be a spending increase, the money for it has to be found and advocated. And that is the first proposal that we've seen to date, which seems to enjoy a consensus across parties. Okay, anything else? What's next here? Okay, and here finally a proposal related to Proposition 13, the familiar split-roll proposal, so that residential and commercial properties can be taxed at a different rate. This has surfaced and resurfaced over the years. You see here a majority opposed, 15%, but again, partisan difference. Democrats quite divided, Republicans almost, sort of overwhelmingly opposed to that idea, which is being floated as a source of new revenue for the state. Okay. Now, finally, let's go to some maybe the more interesting and the newer data, constitutional change. As we all know, one of the big arguments about dealing with what ails California is a sort of an overhaul of the state constitution, a radical overhaul of the state constitution. I want to ask you a sort of a political knowledge question here to get audience participation. How many pages long is the California state constitution? People who think it's less than 50 pages long, put up your hands. No one. Between 50 and 100, put up your hands. No one. Over 100 pages long, put up your hands. Thank you very much. You win. Everybody gets an A. Well, that is totally, totally, totally ridiculous. And the California Constitution is a fundamentally antithetical to the design of the federal Constitution, which confined itself to very general statements of process rather than embedding in the Constitution specific policy prescriptions or specific policies. And the only one that was embedded in there was slavery, and we know how well that worked. So there is obviously almost a prima facie case for constitutional reform given the Constitution. Okay, so what do people say? Iris? Do you think fundamental changes are needed? And, by a substantial, margin of 15% margin or so, people say, yes, we need fundamental change. And here the Democrats are more in favor of fundamental change, independents or people who register with neither party are, and the Republicans are pretty evenly divided on this. So 42% of the Republicans in the abstract say, yes, fundamental change is needed, okay? And here are the sort of the two competing models, which we'll hear about later on, sort of change through a series of initiatives or change through a constitutional convention. And again, you see us, either way in some sense. I don't think people view these as alternatives. They're posed as alternatives. They're posed as alternatives. And so in that context, maybe more people will say, okay, we want a constitutional convention. But I think, both mechanisms for change get receptivity. Okay. But now let's move to the specific proposals that are percolating around there. The first is the notorious two-thirds rule that Proposition 13 includes for increasing state taxes. This is why, I never go anywhere without her. never.
Sorry, Iris. Okay, getting rid of the two-thirds rule. At this point, tough sell. Tough sell to all parties. This is a poll conducted just 3 weeks ago. 60% of the Democrats don't want to give up that rule. Okay? Now, this is kind of really a startling figure. I think, Henry, we both were probably surprised at that outcome. Next one, Iris, is this is a question that we actually invented. So you could say, you know, one of the problems with the state constitution is it's so easy to amend by initiative. You know, two-thirds to pass the budget, two-thirds to raise any individual tax, but just 50% of the voters, you know, can amend the constitution in radical ways. So why not make the process of amending the constitution more difficult, like the federal constitution? And so we said, well, let's try a two-thirds rule for initiatives that, you know, that are constitutional initiatives. And this is favored, okay? Here's a reform that is favored across the board. Very, very little. I mean, this is probably a new idea. People haven't been asked about it before. Maybe they haven't thought about it. There's no sort of partisan queuing on this that people have. So this is kind of a, you know, their first answer. But this is, I think, quite another compelling figure. And next, okay, the simple majority to pass the state budget. And this is more closely divided. And this is, again, a partisan division on this proposal. Okay? Okay. Now, Iris, let's do this. So what we did was we said, okay, there were these three majority rule-related ideas, right? Three separate questions. What was the pattern of, if you, how do people see across these different proposals? And I'm not going to go down the line, but just look the top two figures. The second one is the status quo. Two-thirds for state taxes, two-thirds budget, but add, you know, the status quo, 17% of the total are in the status quo. But the largest single number is for retaining the two-thirds supermajorities that we have and adding that supermajority for the constitutional amendment. So with that pattern of public opinion, you can see that proposals that sort of center on the seemingly compelling democratic idea of simple majority rule runs into resistance among a significant segment of the public, okay? And that goes back to my original point, which I'll now come to the conclusion here, and maybe there'll be a minute or two for questions, okay? Iris, next slide. Oh, sorry, this is an important one. And this just says, okay, let's compare people who said we need a fundamental change and people who say, no, a fundamental change is not needed. And let's look at how they feel on all of these specific things. And here you see the dilemma of achieving change, even where change is desired in the abstract, because you have important partisan divisions, obviously, among people who agree that fundamental change is needed. Okay? You have, on the Democratic side, those who want change, they want the split role, they want more services, they want majority rule as far as taxes and budgeting is concerned. The Republicans, even though they say they want fundamental change, essentially they want the status quo in most things, and you do get a consensus on pay-as-you-go budgeting and on this issue of making it harder to pass a constitutional amendment by initiative, okay? So you see this sort of pattern of public opinion, which now let me very quickly summarize, okay? And I'll conclude. See, I didn't want to say anything concrete here because I didn't want to be held to something that is, you know, inscribed in a PowerPoint slide that people can raise up and say, aha, this is what he said. But here, look, let's just summarize this. One, there is an appetite for change and there is dissatisfaction. Secondly, however, there's a very limited consensus on what to do, and there remains in the public a lot of evidence of partisan gridlock that has to be overcome. I think these data show quite clearly a crisis of trust, a crisis of confidence, and that the public has, in some sense, saying that representative government in California has failed. Is that a fair judgment? I don't know. Is the legislature doing what their constituents want? And this is the outcome. And here you get a standard kind of problem in political science. Each individual representative, each assembly person, is doing what is rational for them. They are serving their constituents. They can't lose, actually, given the way redistricting operates. You have all of these safe seats. But each representative is doing what is in their individually rational interests. But the outcome is collective irrationality. So you have the marriage of individual political rationality and collective irrationality, where you get the state of the University of California essentially flattened in a decade, and you get, you know, this other thing. So what does this all mean? This is all diagnosis. I'm not in the solutions business, thank God, but only in the diagnosis business. You know, you go to another specialist, and we have many of them here. I have a lot of brilliant but unfeasible ideas, which I'm not going to propose. But I will say this. For better or worse, we live in a democracy, and in the end, voters are going to make significant decisions. And so we've had 30 years in which the voters have repudiated the establishment. The idea of a constitutional convention, the idea of engaging in a discourse with the public on a variety of fronts of what is needed and how to do it, I think is absolutely essential. But I think that any solution is going to have to cope with this sort of deep-seated populist mistrust of what has been going on until now. So let me stop with that. I don't know if we have 5 minutes for questions. I guess I'd be willing to answer some or try. Peter Schrag, uh-oh.
I'm coming, Peter, hold on. Thank you. Speak into the mic.
Are those poll data based on returns from voters or from the public in general?
I'm sorry? Okay. PPIC polls are for voters in general. Field uses registered voters.
But they're all voters.
They're people who are registered. They're people who are registered to vote. Not broken down by likely voters or how did they vote.
My question was a little simpler. Is it the public at large or is it only voters?
Well, you could break this down, and if you get the public at large, you probably will have, given sort of the difference between the electorate and the public, which we're all familiar with, right? The electorate is older, whiter, et cetera, so you will probably get more of a push towards these kinds of more conservative kinds of solutions. But, you know, in the end, voters vote. In the end, it is the voters who end up participating. So as far as the sampling of this is concerned, the Field Institute polls are of registered voters. These are samples taken from registered voter rolls. Mark Baldessari at PPIC does it differently. Okay, he has a kind of a general population sample. Okay?
Thanks.
Wonderful. No questions. This is like teaching poli sci one. You know, whereas the coffee break, see the way I teach it, I say no laptops, no cell phones, no Blackberries, turn them off. And so they're just yearning for the time to end so that they can turn on their cell phones. So you can tell, turn on your cell phones. I've been asked by Chris to say we're going to have a 10-minute break and then we move on to the next panel.